Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome to Found Flix. Just got back from seeing Blair Witch, The Next Generation. And no, Wash is not going to be my co-host today, but I'm sure he has his own opinions about the Blair Witch. But welcome back, Paul! He's back. He's here for you. That's right. After many moons of waiting, there's finally a new Blair Witch movie. And it's been a long time coming, but, you know, it's hard to say if it's been worth it because the original was so monumental in its time. Is it possible even for something nowadays to stack up to the original? And Paul actually was a huge fan of the original, and so I kind of wondered, you know, what it was like being a fan and live in the time of 99 when it was coming out. Like, what did you think of the movie, the original, when you first saw it?
I kind of got swept up in the hype. You know, I think like a normal person, when I heard that it was this found footage movie that was possibly real or whatever, I did a very small amount of research to find out that it was clearly just a movie. It wasn't actually like the found footage of these poor dead college students.
That are dead now.
So I understood going into it that it was fake. I guess as the movie has aged out or whatever, there are some detractors and some people think it's boring or it's scary. There's you don't see a lot happening in the movie. It's more about what's happening off screen.
Yeah, well, that's the whole concept. Is what's kind of different between the original and this one is it's all about what you're imagining as the viewer.
Yeah, which is why I think it's so effective. And yeah. I mean, I haven't seen it in a long time, but I saw it in the theater probably 6 or 7 times. I took everyone that I knew to see it. Like, I was one of those people.
And yeah, yeah.
Most of them, you know, it was pretty effective for most of the people that I took. So to this day, I'm still a big fan.
So the original was so huge and it ushered in a whole, essentially regenerated the found footage genre. And it's been taken in so many directions since then with things like VHS, which actually involved the director of this movie and screenwriter as well. And so it's like, can these guys actually stack up to something that could, you know, actually go alongside the original or maybe even surpass it? And I think that's such a difficult task to even consider because of all those other factors. Like you said, people thought it was necessarily like real, maybe, and all this kind of stuff too, that adds this whole other layer to it.
Discounting the cash grab bullshit sequel that doesn't
Book of Shadows.
Book of Shadows.
It's not referenced in this movie, and so it doesn't matter.
No,
at all. I don't want to miss dojo.
It's utter trash. But the fact that so Blair Witch was 99, and here we are in 2016. The fact that there was, I would say, an honest to goodness sequel after so much time, 17 years or whatever.
Yeah.
I went into it really thinking that there was a good, like there was going to be something really substantial and possibly mind-blowing to this movie.
Yeah, and I mean, a lot of it is, when it comes to the original, is about that ending, or like the last 10 minutes or so when they're in the cabin, and then, you know, the final shot where you don't actually know what happens.
Yeah.
I mean, the assumption is that nobody got out of there.
Sure.
No one's okay. But so I thought that actually was a good concept for the sequel to take, as far as now it's this many years later, and this, you know, brother of the Heather character from the first one is trying to find out what happened to her, because we don't actually know as viewers. All we can do is kind of speculate and assume that she died, and that's the best that we can figure from what we saw in the original. So I think it's a really strong concept to be able to take with this kind of reboot sequel that they've taken. And so I was excited for that reason too, and of course the director and writer.
You know, you'd mentioned earlier, like, so the brother, I mean, sure, he's older now, he's college age or whatever, so it makes more sense now why he would be doing that. But why didn't this happen 10 years ago?
Yeah, even in like 2000.
So they kind of justify it in the movie in that they meet this guy, they end up meeting this guy who, like, a year or something before had uploaded video onto YouTube of a DV tape that he found just under the roots of some tree in the forest.
Black Hills Forest,
right? In Black Hills Forest, and he uploaded it, and it sort of shows what you may think is...
It's his sister. It looks like
sister.
It could be his sister. So the whole thing with this 2016 Next Generation version is kind of taking what worked about the original and the overall concepts and kind of scares, and kind of turning it up and amplifying it for a modern audience, or for 2016. Certainly a lot of stuff has changed in horror since then, and it's, you know, it's a big kind of reflection of that difference when you kind of try to compare the original one to this one, and where they would take a different choice as far as what they would show or might not show in the original and stuff like that. So one of the things that's kind of very different about this one is that you actually see the witch on screen, which you didn't see in the original. And I think that was an active choice, though I actually did read that they actually did at one point shoot footage that would have included the witch in the first one.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was. There's a point when Heather's running and she goes, "What the fuck is that? Yeah. What the fuck?" Yeah. And she kind of pans over and it's just darkness.
Right.
But I guess there actually was a dude standing there.
And they just didn't...
They didn't catch it. Because the film was too slow or whatever, so it just didn't catch any of that
image.
Oh,
for real? That's cool, man. Because I actually love that scene. When I saw it with a friend, they said when they saw the trees, they thought it was a gigantic stick figure.
Oh,
like a 20-foot stick figure just fucking off to the side.
That would have been
Which,
gnarly.
Like, even though it clearly wasn't, like, just hearing that... just kind of freaks you out.
Of course, that's like a very old concept of not showing the monster or whatever the critter is. Like, the fear is in someone's mind is scarier than what you could ever actually show on screen.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. And I would, I don't, I think that this movie still could have played with that idea and not shown anything, and I think people would have been accepting of it. And I think what we did see ultimately didn't add a whole lot.
That's true. I mean, so that's kind of a very, very easy way to describe the whole thing, because like what you said, it's more of a remake than what you might expect, and they kind of fall back on the similar concepts or kind of scares that were seen in the first one as far
how it's spoilers, right? So yeah. I mean the end of the movie ends in a house. It literally just ends up kind of just being a prolonged version of the first movie.
Right. I mean, it's more drawn out and it's more interesting than the first version. But I mean, the whole, I would say the 50 minutes up to it is even more kind of indicative of that, like, remake where it's like, here goes some more people in the woods, and they kind of escalate what happens over time, but...
Well, it's like three times as many people now.
That's true. I mean, so that's the whole thing. When you go into Blair Witch 2016, instead of three people, fuck that. That's not enough people. Six people.
Yeah.
That's a lot more people to get eaten by witches. Fact. And then we got all these cameras. We got cameras from every angle. We got drones. We got everything you need. Fact. But does that make it any better? Not really, though.
I don't know. You definitely get to see more POV cameras drop to the forest ground and then see a limp body get dragged off screen.
Yep. They think by adding more, that inherently will make it more interesting or possibly a more kind of thrilling adventure for everyone. But I think that actually, for the most part, worked to its detriment, actually, instead of being an improvement. Whereas, like, we were talking about this a little bit earlier, where by it being six people, you kind of don't get the same level of development for the characters when it's only three people. I mean, that made a huge impact on the overall movie itself.
I agree.
Because of that.
No, absolutely. I don't know that there was character development so much as, like, people stated what was going on, or you saw things happen to people that sort of, like, the girl with the... who got her foot cut. That was her whole character.
Yeah,
was
her foot
her
got
foot
cut.
Got fucked up and she got infected and it got worse and worse and then she climbed a tree.
And then it was better.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah.
Sure, whatever.
Better for a little bit.
When it comes to the actual journey of the characters, like, I like the concept of it, but the specifics of the characters didn't really work. Whereas the James character is searching for his sister, whatever, 15 years later. Like, was she a survivalist? Was it fucking, like, Bear Grylls going into the forest 15 years ago? I don't think so. It was just some girl who, when they ran out of smokes, was losing her mind. So there's no way this chick has survived this long in the forest.
How cool would it have been if they just stumbled upon, like, a giant tree fork?
And it's like, no boys allowed. Heather's house, Heather's hovel. That's one thing that kind of annoyed me when I saw the synopses for the movies, is one of the things it described was, you will find out what happened to Heather. You will find out.
Really?
And it's like, okay, great. Yeah, count me in. Here's my $11. Let's go see this bitch. What do they got for me? And you don't find out. Other than she's probably dead. She's probably still dead. It was 15 years later. She's dead.
Yeah, she's still dead.
She's still dead. Yeah. She was dead back then. Dead now.
Remains
dead. Yeah, exactly. Also, again, another element with the new technology and the drones. They say that thanks to the drones, they can finally fight back against this witch, you know?
Yeah.
And I was like, wow, sweet. They're going to really sort of use the new technology that has advanced in that time since the first one and kind of have this new element to it or something.
You know what? Drone got stuck in a tree.
Drone did nothing. and then got stuck in a tree, and that was it.
And my favorite part was Ashley?
Yeah.
Wants to use the drone when she finds it in the tree. She climbs up into the tree. It's dark. The drone has no lights.
Well, even if it did have a light on it, it's not going to illuminate a whole...
Nothing.
Like hundreds of feet of forest.
You're not going to see... It's not going to even illuminate like the canopy right below it.
That's true.
You will see nothing.
Yeah.
That was weird. This movie, the sound design was completely insane.
Almost... Probably the most obnoxious part of it, I would say.
It was
because
super distracting.
The original is so natural with what it does with that, like what you were just talking about. And the new one is very... It
sounded like explosions.
It's just very modern horror.
Yeah.
That's why it's too boisterous for its own good. It's trying to add the terror with the sound rather than what you're seeing is what is actually scary.
Yeah, yeah,
absolutely. And that's where it just failed to... achieve the same level as the original when it came to that. Didn't need a soundtrack. I mean, you have people running through the woods and they're freaking out and Heather's screaming her balls off and stuff, and that was enough. You didn't need like these weird soundscapes going on in the background while that's happening.
Yeah.
You know? And even it was smart in the original because they had one camera that's a handy cam and then one that's a black and white 16mm, so that would give you a differentiating kind of look, whereas this is very smooth and it just looks more like a movie most of the time.
Very much so, yeah. Like the earpieces, there were so many setups that could have been gimmicks in a good way.
Yes.
Actually didn't really pay off. Like, wouldn't it have been cool if a character disappeared and then suddenly you see from the perspective of like the ear cam and they're like rushing through the forest and you're just like, what's happening?
What the
and then
happening?
Suddenly you see from the other perspective and it's their head and it just comes flying out of the forest and lands in the campfire.
Oh my god.
Like, well,
that would have been the best thing in the whole movie. So that was kind of what was weird about this movie, is that there were concepts that they had at their disposal that they didn't really take advantage of. And a new concept that was introduced in this movie is that the actual woods themselves and sort of the physical layout of things can actually be manipulated by the Blair Witch. You know, the same thing happens as in the first one, where our characters this time are going around in a circle and they end up back at their previous camp and they start going cuckoo crazy.
Yeah.
And, you know, they just don't really do that much with that. It seems to be that this time aspect, or where time is kind of skipping or looping and kind of different than what is normal, is tied most to the Lane character, who's this kind of local, towny kind of guy. The whole thing is, at one point, he and his girlfriend Talia separate from the main group, and during this time is when they're encountering all this crazy shit. We've seen Lane's footage from his camera at other points in the movie, but during the time when it would have been the most interesting to see, zero footage, no footage.
You didn't get to see the best part of the movie.
Yeah, so that's why the thing that you see is that our characters are like, hey, what's going on? Ha! Lane and Talia, where'd you guys come from? And they're like, yo, we've been in the forest for 5 days and it's really crazy and weird. What the fuck is happening?
Yeah.
And you're like, wait, what happened with you guys?
Instead, we see a guy get crushed by a tree.
Yeah, a tree falls on fucking Peter. That's all we get.
In the first movie, when weird shit like that happened, it was occasionally addressed. Maybe not in a big way, but it was at least addressed. In this movie, like, there's a weird thing. It was in the first day or two where they wake up at 2 p.m., and which is really crazy. And, like, they mention that,
and like,
they sort
whoa.
Of talk about that being crazy. Like, how
can't
did
believe
we,
how long we
how
slept
did all
in,
of us sleep
y'all.
Till 2? And then someone sort of brings it up, but... No one really talks
like,
about how fucked up they
listen,
are.
Reality is bending around you.
Completely.
That's more important than Heather and all this other shit.
There was no, like two people, you know, the main two people.
Yeah.
Who sort of had this weird romantic thing going together. Why didn't they ever, like, go back into their tent and be like,
what the fuck is going on?
We both realize what's happening.
It's crazy.
We're maybe not getting out of here.
One thing that it seemed over-reliant on leading up to the house, which was the definite highlight of the movie by a fucking long shot,
It
basically makes it worth you sitting through everything to get to that point. With its highs and lows, I mean, it has good and bad getting to that
first
point.
First half of the movie is pretty boring.
Yeah.
I have to say.
Yeah. And he was excited. He
was
really
was
stoked.
Super,
he was so excited. That's why, I mean, I'm the jaded guy that hates everything. And he was like, hey, it could be good.
I've been super psyched for this movie
yeah.
for... for a couple months.
Exactly. So that's why it's interesting that it took that much time, but it seems so over-reliant on very noisy jump scares.
Yeah.
And it wasn't ever the witch doing it. It was another cast member being like, hey!
There were a lot of stupid...
And I mean, they even have really Lisa did that in the movie. Like, stop doing that! Like, after the fifth time it happened.
That annoyed me. Yeah, that was horrible.
So with that in mind, here's us showing you how to do jump scares. Jump scares 101. Paul! Hello? What? What was that? Did you guys hear that? Oh my god, what the fuck was that? It sounded like it was coming from in here, but I can't be too sure unless I investigate. Oh, Jesus!
Hey, dude, it's me, Paul. What's going on?
Oh, fuck, dude. Fuck you, Paul.
I think you broke my goddamn nose.
Not cool, man. There's so many things to the movie that kind of leave you wanting more, where it's like they could have done more with their own concept, but where it finally comes into fruition, I feel like, or where it kind of excelled a lot, is when they make it to... what has to be Rustin Parr's cabin house, because it's two stories, three stories.
It's not even make it to. It just finally materializes.
It presents itself to them. James walks into the cabin, and he sees... there's so many doors. There's like seven doors or something that he sees. Like, why would the guy that made the cabin actually ever need that many doors, you know?
Right, or that many stories.
That's true.
There were like two basements and... five attics. I don't know.
Seriously, I think that's pretty accurate.
But no, yeah, that was cool. Only because it's just sort of that effect. They, you know, taking advantage of the found footage thing, where you're going around a corner every 5 seconds, and you know, there's maybe going to be something horrible. Maybe
that's why
not.
You don't know at that point. You know that it's not good that they're back in that cabin, because that's where obviously Heather was lost.
Yeah,
and even before they go into the cabin, James thinks he hears Heather's voice.
Right.
We don't hear anything.
I did like that. I did like there were focuses on like other characters sort of responding to him.
Yeah. Like, what are you hearing?
He was hearing stuff, and you as the audience or the other characters.
Well, that ties into the Rustin Parr thing again, from what I'd read online and stuff, that it's like he was actually hearing the voices and stuff and seeing the witch, but no one else was.
Oh, cool.
So that's why it was that same kind of concept. So that's
cool.
It actually is cool.
No, it is cool. I'm sorry. I'm being a asshole. Cool.
When we're in the cabin, and it's very different than when the original trio, or, well, I guess it wasn't the original trio. It was just the two that were left at that point.
Mike and Heather.
Yeah, because Josh went missing. And so when they're going through the cabin, it's very direct, and there's not much scene, and then that movie ends. But with this time, we're presented with, it's almost like kind of a haunted house in a way, or like kind of a demented fun house, because you can actually see that reality is bending, not explicitly like through visual effects, but that it is more than what would make any sense in reality. Obviously, again, he thought he heard his sister in there, and so this is what we've been waiting for the whole goddamn movie. Is he gonna find Heather? Is she in the fucking estate? Is she dead? Has she turned into a witch? What the fuck has happened to Heather? You know what I'm saying? That's what we've been waiting for this whole time.
The answers, they are a-coming.
Before you get any answers, I mean, I guess you see James goes into a room and sees Peter in the corner momentarily and then disappears.
Right.
But then we cut away from that, and then Lisa's back outside, and Lisa's independent of everyone else, and, well, the only other person that's alive.
And well, she didn't want to go in.
Yeah.
But then she sees the witch.
Right.
Peer out from behind it.
Yeah, exactly. So that's when the first time we get a really good glimpse. We saw one very minor glimpse earlier, and it's still very, very brief. Very brief.
Yeah.
I started calling it the Slender Witch.
Yeah.
Because it's Slender Man plus a spooky witch lady. That's what it looks like. Evelyn or whatever, the actual lady who was taken by the citizens of Blair and, you know, accused of witchcraft, that she was actually put on this sort of thing that sort of stretched her limbs out. And so when you see the witch in this movie, that's what she looks like. She's extremely tall and has stretched out arms and legs.
Long, lanky limbs.
Long and lanky and just like white and stuff. And I mean, it's pretty fucking creepy looking for
pretty
sure.
Creepy.
Reminded us both of Wreck. We thought of that.
Yeah, that's why it didn't Wreck. Super work for me, only because I had seen that movie. Otherwise, like, it probably would have...
If you didn't see Wreck, the ending is amazing.
Otherwise, it probably would have scared the shit out of me.
Yeah. No, I mean, I still liked what they were.
It was still
for.
Effective.
Yes,
it was
exactly.
Cool. And it's cool that
and they
like
they
you said,
still...
they had to show, so it's
yeah,
what they showed.
Yeah, yeah. So with modern horror, you have to show something because children don't have any imagination anymore. Their cell phones have destroyed their brains. But anyway, so Lisa goes into the cabin and we actually get what is probably the most intense part of the movie to me is when she's in the cabin and she's exploring and is hearing voices again. And then Lane...
She gets attacked by Lane.
And then Lane pops up, who's been missing. Again, he's dealing with all this time travel shit. Or basically, I mean, that's what it is. His time is independent for him.
He's controlled or is working for.
Yeah, and then the witch. He shows up, he starts spouting about you have to do what she says and stuff like that. And that's why I sort of thought that Lane was kind of the new Rustin Parr and had actually been drawing these new kids out there to bring more victims to the witch. Clearly, it's been a longer time, too, since we've seen him last. He's got like a beard, yeah. And his hair's all frazzled and he's just dirty and shit. Throws Lisa into some tunnels that are actually underneath the cellar. So the same cellar we saw in the first one, but there's even catacombs beneath it, which
when they mentioned before. They'd mentioned that it was like possibly part of the Underground Railroad or something. Yeah. So that was.
And then so Lisa's trying to get out of the cabin and going through the tunnels, and that again to me that was the most like
pretty tense. Yeah, that was cool. I like that. You're expecting something to grab her ankle.
Well, that's the whole thing. You're just sitting there, just like, when is it going to happen?
She's putting the camera to like see her light, to see have light to keep her going through, find where she's going. Anything could have happened. Well, especially cool that nothing did.
That's true. She gets stuck, and you're like, okay, she's boned. That's it. And then she's. Gets brave enough and, breaks through anxiety or whatever to be able to keep going.
Yeah.
But when she breaks out, she's in another part of the cabin or the house.
Sure.
And so there is no escaping, actually.
Yeah.
And that's when the movie sort of mirrors the actual beginning of this movie, where...
Yeah, you sort of learn that the footage that drew them out into the forest initially... was actually from the future and was sort of their own demise.
Right? Yep, basically.
Basically.
Yeah. So, I mean, even though Lane at that point was dead and all that stuff, like, he was able to have gotten the footage from previously in the future to be able to bring it back to draw
to
them
give
out.
To himself.
When she gets out of the tunnels, then Lane appears again and she actually stabs him and kills him at that point and then finds her way back to James. Who was separated, so we haven't even seen him this whole time.
For a really long
time. It's been a really long time.
Even though he's essentially the main character.
He's the main character. He's the driving force of the movie that brought everyone out into the woods
just
in the first
place.
Just
not really involved in the third act.
Yeah, he just didn't have a lot to do then. He was just like chilling in some room. Again, what was his actual... That's why I would love to see his footage this whole time.
He heard Heather knocking on a wall and he was like...
Twice for yes. Are you scared? You know, you're like, okay, we got something. But yeah, so that she comes back and she reunites with James and, the witch is right on her trail. And that was probably right before she meets up with James again is when we get the fullest shot of the witch when it's actually chasing after her in the hallway very briefly.
Yes.
And so you see that it's really goddamn tall. Like, it had to kind of, like, lean down to even fit into the hallway, sort of. But so they know, listen, you just can't look at the witch. All you got to do is face in the corner, like we saw Mike. We don't really know what happened to him. I mean, as far as him choosing to look in the corner, he was just doing it.
Yeah, so basically in the first movie, you see the perspective of the camera looking at someone in the corner. So the only way to really accentuate that is to then just see the POV of what it looks like who's there at a corner.
Yep.
As there's a witch behind you, it's the climax of the movie.
Yeah, and so...
There's a camera staring into a corner trying not to look at a witch.
Well, that's why, so Lisa can't look in the corner, but she has her DSLR, I'm sure, with an articulating screen.
Sure.
So that she can turn it around. So she's looking behind her, but not technically looking.
Well, it's like if you did that to Medusa.
That's what I was just thinking about Medusa.
Get you.
Medusa would be like, shucks! They figured out how to defeat me.
Technology.
They're forcing themselves to stay looking in the corner, except that James then hears Heather's voice, which we also didn't hear again. I didn't hear Heather's voice. Did you?
I didn't know.
Yeah. So he didn't actually hear her voice, or we didn't hear her voice. The audience didn't. But he turns around. Mope. He's done. Later, bud.
Yeah.
And then it's down to Lisa, who's, again, using her DSLR to
She's
be able
like
to look behind
up.
Her. Back
trying to find her way out of
where you
the
gonna go, bitch?
Place. Yeah.
Where are you going? But regardless, before she even gets out of Parr's place, that
which basically she does some ventriloquism, yeah, blows her voice to sound like her
hey,
buddy.
It's me, James. I'm totally cool. I'm over here. Why don't you turn around real quick? And then she does. And it's the exact same ending as the first one. She falls, her camera falls to the ground and
runs for a little while. So, is Mike alive? Did Mike dig dirt around in Blair Witch Project? Is he okay?
It's been 15 years, Paul. I mean, you know, like, what? How would you know?
It would be amazing if he showed up sort of in like a Robin Williams Jumanji.
Well, that's kind of what I was waiting for. I mean, like I was saying, as far as them.
You really thought Heather was going to show up.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I really
it was. It was like a total cock tease.
It's really weird.
She never showed up.
It's really
even
weird.
A voice or, you know, 15 years later and whatever.
Like I said, like Blair Witch maybe needs a body. Heather shows up.
That's all it takes.
Possessed by the witch.
The tiniest thing. And then he's like, oh my God, it's my sister. I can't believe it's you. And she's like, James, thank you. You've come to save me. And then, like, chops his head off.
Totally.
And you would have been like, tits! Because that would have been awesome. That would have been way better than nothing.
There was no psychological torment of the main character. It was really weird.
Yeah. It was just, like, general psychological torment. Which leads me to believe...
Just for everyone.
Like, Well, yeah. So, like, it's the whole thing with... What does a witch actually want from these people? Like, I understand she likes killing people. That's made abundantly clear.
Yeah.
But so she was getting revenge for the people that accused her of witchcraft. You know what? She was a witch. Clearly, because she's still alive 200 fucking years later and can make trees move around and shit. So they were actually right to try to burn her and all that stuff they
Absolutely.
Did.
Absolutely.
I mean, what else would you have done? Like, oh, she's a witch. It's cool. Don't even worry about it. Let's get back to churning butter or whatever.
Know.
You're just waiting for something really... I mean, not concrete, but just substantial paying off. That's what it is, the paying off of the Heather aspect. That you're going to find out what happens to her. And the answer is you don't. And you don't know what happened to these cocksuckers in this movie either. They're just gone too. You know what I mean? Like,
man, and it didn't even have to be like a special effect. Find a fucking grave.
Yeah.
That would have been like
That's true.
Kind of weird and disheartening and like just kind of a bummer. Like, give us a bummer moment. There weren't even, like, really any of those. It was just,
That's
like,
true.
Scary.
It was just, like, just
like
these people kind of flailing around
in the woods. Like, at least
in
Blair Witch Project, they unwrap a...
Yeah, the bundle of sticks, and it's got Josh's, like, shirt and some of his teeth and shit in there.
His teeth and his tongue are in it.
Yeah.
What?
That's messed up. That's
really
way
bad.
Way messed up.
Not good.
And that would have been interesting if it was even, like, again, like, using that to tease the main character with, that they get that same bundle of sticks, but
it's like Peter's dick.
No, I meant like...
Sorry.
Yeah, that would have been pretty rad, too.
I don't want to take another take.
Big old black schlong, but no, that was the take we're using. I mean, it would have been cool if they would have used that same concept, but with Heather, so that they find a bundle of sticks outside of their tents, but it's like her necklace or something. Like,
yeah.
Oh my God, I remember, you know, Mom gave her this necklace
Absolutely.
On her.
Even if it was something as... stupid as like a driver's license. Like, even that would have been kind of weird.
But so, I mean, in the end, it was a sort of impossible for them to recreate the original or the success that the original had as a movie, not just the marketing aspect, which they were smart with as far as like, you didn't know that the woods was actually Blair Witch. And, you know, it wasn't until at Comic-Con that they announced it actually was the new Blair Witch. So that was at least smart, and they try to kind of create their own hype that wouldn't have necessarily existed if you would have just gone to see a movie and went, oh, there's the new Blair Witch movie, like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but ultimately that was the most interesting part of it.
Yeah, in retrospect, you're right, kind of,
still,
is that...
Still cool, though.
That was the most successful part
of it.
It
was a lot of fun hearing about it.
Yeah, no, yeah. I mean, that's true. I mean, but again, compared to the original, where it wasn't even necessarily just like a standard movie production, it was like them sort of... giving these little notes to the actors, and it was this very like organic process of them in the woods, and you know what I mean, they orchestrated all these, they were kind of like behind the scenes putting their actors into these scenarios and like live letting them interact
and
with it
fucking with them.
They sort of done the same thing as the original, gotten people that have never been anything before and utilized that aspect of maybe it was scripted, the new one, I don't know. But it felt very scripted. It never felt organic. It never felt real.
I mean, clearly, just the way that movie was filmed versus the way this movie was filmed, there was genuine fright and They went through an actual experience.
And you did too.
And you did too. Absolutely.
That's why that was the main factor of why I think the first one is more successful.
This movie actually made me like the first one better.
I actually had the same exact response.
Yeah.
Again, the whole element of the modern horror showing you the monster and showing more characters and trying to beef it up and stuff, it just didn't do any. It wasn't for the betterment of the plot or the stuff like that. Where with the original, with there only being three people and no nothing shown,
nothing.
That's actually way more difficult to pull off than like, oh, we got six people. People are getting snapped in half. We got this fucking drone in a tree and all. You know, I mean, you got everything at your disposal in that same kind of format. I mean, it's not like a $100 million movie. So why the hell would you even do that? But that it's actually more difficult to create what the original did than what the new one was trying to go for, and the new one still didn't actually pay off on the concept of cranking it to the max. I think that's what I would say was its downfall.
Completely agree.
Still wasn't bad. The cabin portion was cool. The concept of the time bending and adding more kind of detail to that was cool. But
the last half is a lot of fun, I think.
I think we've officially exhausted everything we could say about this movie. But before we go, I want to talk about, a shout out to my pals over at Horror Addicts, another YouTube channel that's going through some tough times right now. They got kind of screwed out of their lease, and they have a GoFundMe page that they have set up right now in order to help them in their kind of tough time. So make sure to check out the link in the description. You can check out their GoFundMe page and make sure to donate if you have a couple extra bucks. I mean, anything will help. I can only understand how tough that is to be going through that stuff that they are. So help everyone out in our horror community. It's the right thing to do. Paul's gonna donate $6,000, he told me earlier. Mm-hmm. He doesn't have that kind of money.
It's just 1 month's paycheck.
Yeah, exactly. Baller Paul over here. All right, well, thank you so much for watching, you guys. What did you think about the new Blair Witch movie, and what do you think in relation to the first one? Does the new one stack up? Do you think Adam Wingard and Simon Barrett did a good enough job? Or did it leave you wanting more like Paul and I felt? Leave your thoughts in the comments below, and make sure to subscribe to FoundFlix.
Oh my god, it's right behind me! Oh my god!
Dude, where the fuck have you
been? What? Paul, you're alive?
Get in the corner! Oh, get in the corner! She can't see you!
That corner?
Just face the corner!
I'm in the corner!
This is my corner!
No, let me share! You can share the corner!
Share the fucking corner! But be quiet, dude!
Okay.
Shh!
Okay.
Just be quiet.
It's coming. It's right behind us. Don't look. Don't. Do you hear that? Do you hear that?
I don't hear anything.
She's here.
Who?
She's finally came.
What?
My baby. She's here.
What?
My scarlet?
What? What is he talking about?
For what? Ice cream! Oh! Shit! Oh!